good evening, everyone. Good to see you this evening. And the word that was on my heart today to share with you is faith like gold. Faith like gold. And I've got some scriptures to share with you this evening. Here we go. The main text that hit me was in Revelation chapter 3, verse 14 to 21. And to the angel of the Laodiceans write, "These things says the Amen, the faithful and true witness, the beginning of creation of God. I know your works, that you are neither cold nor hot. I could wish that you were cold or hot. So then, because you are lukewarm and neither cold nor hot, I'll vomit you out of my mouth. Because you say, 'I'm rich, have become wealthy, and have need of nothing,' and do not know that you are wretched, miserable, poor, blind, and naked. I counsel you to buy from me gold refined in the fire, that you may be rich, and white garments, that you may be clothed." And it was there in verse 18 that it really grabbed me, this verse, this thought. And out of this scripture that I've highlighted in purple came the whole train of thoughts that I want to share with you tonight about faith as gold. So here's Jesus, and he's speaking to the Laodiceans. And most of you will know that this church is in compromise. It's neither hot nor cold. And also, they have a false perception of themselves spiritually and who they are. We see in verse 17, before we come to this verse that I've highlighted, that they're saying that they're rich, wealthy, and of need of nothing. So the picture here is a group of people that are self-sufficient, don't believe they need anything. Don't believe they need to grow, don't believe anything's needed. They're rich, they're wealthy, and they have need of nothing. So get that picture in your mind of this self-sufficiency mindset. And in verse, and then Jesus says, actually, you're the opposite. You're miserable, poor, blind, and naked, all right? They think they're rich and they're self-sufficient, but actually, from God's point of view, they're poor. And then he says this, "I counsel you to buy from me gold refined in the fire, that you may be rich." And that's the thing that struck me, this verse. "I counsel you to buy from me gold refined in the fire, that you may be rich." What is this gold? And how do you buy it? Interesting, isn't it? It's not a gift. It's come and buy this gold. And this gold is pure gold that's been through a refining experience. You know the how they refine gold. They put it in very, very strong heat, strong fire, and it becomes so hot that as the gold melts, what happens is the impurities that make the gold less strong and pure, the impurities will rise to the surface in this superheated fiery gold. And then you can skim off from the gold all the impurities. And what's left is a higher carat of gold, stronger, purer. So this gold that God is saying, you know, "I advise you to buy it from me," is refined gold. And we know, as we'll see in a few scriptures I want to show you now, that that gold is often seen as a picture of faith. Here in 1 Peter 1, verse 6 to 7. "In this you greatly rejoice, though now for a little while, if need be, you have been grieved by various trials, that the genuineness of your faith, being much more precious than gold, which perishes, though it's tested by fire, may be found to the praise, honour and glory at the revelation of Jesus Christ." So here, 1 Peter 1, 6, 7, The genuineness of your faith, that word there means the authenticity of your faith, the reality of your faith. It's the real thing. Have you ever seen fake gold? I can't remember where I went, but I went somewhere and there was loads of fake gold. And as a kid, I thought, this is great. It wasn't gold at all. It was some other type of material. But it looked like gold, but it wasn't gold. It was fake gold. Well, here, what Peter is saying is, look, you might go through some difficulties, but the point is that the genuineness of your faith, or the purity of your faith, being more precious than gold that perishes, may be found to praise, honor, and glory. So if you think about what has just been said in Revelation, it says, I counsel you to buy from me gold, refined in the fire, that you may be rich. So in God's eyes, a rich Christian is rich in faith, rich in faith. And it's the opposite to what those Laodiceans were. They were miserable, poor and blind and naked because they thought that they were rich and wealthy and have need of nothing, self-sufficient. And what God was saying is, you need to purchase from me gold refined in the fire. Now, I was thinking, what is this gold and how do you buy it? Well, I think that Peter shows us, and I've got a few other scriptures as well, that this gold is your faith. This gold is your purified faith. And how do you buy this gold? Well, the gold is faith. But I also think the currency is faith too. So I believe that believing God and trusting God in adverse situations, or believing God for his call on your life or the promises that he's given to you, believing God is currency. Now, I wouldn't take that too, you know, far as an analogy, but just think of it now. How do I get this gold from God? You purchase it. What do I purchase it with? Faith, trusting God, believing God. We know, don't we, that in the Gospels, often people receive from Jesus according to their faith and their trust in him. That's how we gain the promises of God. How do we gain the promises of God? God may give us promises, but how do those promises come to pass from our perspective? Or from our perspective, those promises come to pass by believing God, by having faith in the God of the promises that were given and being faithful to the God of the promises. So I believe that to purchase this gold refined in fire, we do this by believing God and trusting God, and that will purchase us this beautiful gold mentioned to us in 1 Peter. Got a few other scriptures just to show. So the genuineness of your faith, or the purity of your faith, being more precious than gold that perishes. So can you see how the genuineness of our faith, or like I said, the authenticity of our faith, the purity of our faith, is more precious than gold, than real gold? And gold is precious. It's the most, historically and biblically, it was the most precious of things that you could have. Gold was always seen as valuable and precious. And so here, Jesus, having said in Revelation, buy gold from me. Wow, it's the most precious thing that we can get. And here, your faith is more precious than gold. And your faith becomes more precious than gold because it's tested and it's purified and it becomes valuable. Your faith as gold becomes valuable, so valuable that it will be praised, honored, and it will bring glory to Jesus. So our faith is gold. Let's read a few other scriptures here in Malachi chapter 3, verse 2 to 3. Who can endure the day of his coming, and who can stand when he appears? For he is like a refiner's fire and a launderer's soap. He will sit as a refiner and purifier of silver. And he will purify them as gold and silver. Excuse me. He will purge them as gold and silver, that they may offer to the Lord an offering of righteousness. So here, in Malachi chapter 3, again, silver and gold is often used together as precious stones. But here, who is going to stand during the difficult period? And who, when he appears, will be able to stand with faith? And he says, well, God is a refiner and a purifier, and he's going to purify the priests, the sons of Levi, and purge them as gold and silver. So what is this gold? It's their faith. It's their obedience that comes out of faith. It's their trust in God. And we see in the next verse, Job 23, verse 10, and we all know what Job went through before he came out to be seven times as blessed at the end of the trial than he was at the when he went into it. And Job says, but he knows the way that I take. When he tested me, I shall come forth as gold. So Job, even though he was struggling with God and his situation and circumstances, the one thing that Job didn't do is give up on God. He asked all the questions he couldn't understand, but, you know, he believed God. Though he slay me, I'll yet trust him. That's pretty powerful faith. And through all those chapters in Job, you see a purifying going on. And until finally God turns up, and by the end of his encounter with God, his faith has been tested, purified, and has become very, very pure like gold, so much so that James uses him as an example of perseverance. And then here again, Psalm 66, verse 10, for you, God, tested us and refined us like silver. I know it's used silver, but silver and gold is the same. It's the same thought here. Again, Zechariah 13:9. I hope you can see there's a theme here. I will refine them like silver and test them like gold. They will call on my name and I will answer them. I will say, these are my people, and they will say, the Lord is our God. And so God wants us to purchase from him something precious. He wants us to purchase, to get from him something precious. What is the most precious thing in this set? One of the most precious things that we can get from God, that God prizes? Well, it's purity of faith and everything that springs from that. Because purity of trusting God and believing God will change our lives, change our actions, will bring us into greater levels of obedience, not obedience from the law, but obedience that springs from the heart of trusting God, believing God, holding on to God personally, having high levels of faith. And that faith, what's happening is not just through tests and trials that you immediately think of the difficult things in life, but day by day, God is wanting to make our faith purer, our trust stronger, our leaning on him greater. It's the opposite to the Laodiceans, who were lukewarm. I mean, they were strong Christians, were they? They were lukewarm. They were neither hot nor cold. They were just, you know, indifferent. But they were indifferent because they thought they were so good. They were self-sufficient. So in order to buy gold from God and have a preciousness of faith, which is more precious than gold, that Peter says, we have to be the opposite to the Laodiceans. We have to be poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of God. We have to humble ourselves, and we have to come to new levels of self-reliance. Lord, I really need you. And not to trust in our own abilities, or to say, I've got everything I need, I don't need God anymore. You know, many people, many Christians are in danger of becoming lukewarm, of, you know, treating the faith lightly because they've got so much. because, like the Laodiceans, they think they've got the money they need, the lifestyle that they've desired. They've got all these wonderful things, materially perhaps, or a great career, or a lovely retirement settlement. I don't know, but you know, they really don't need God at the moment, and we know that because we rarely see them. They're entangled in the things of the world and the riches of the world and all that the world has to offer, and they become Laodicean because they're self-sufficient. But God has a way sometimes of bringing us out of our self-sufficiency, and often that might need to be a trial. I think he prefers it when we self-yield, but if we won't self-yield, God will bring some things into our lives that will help us yield. And coming to that yielding, you begin to change, and you begin to know that you really do need God, that he's not just an optional extra in your lifestyle, or the God in your pocket that you can pull out when you want and put away when you want. That there's this sense of, Lord, I need you. Every hour I need you. Even when I'm blessed, I'm totally dependent on you. Even when things are going well, I know that should you leave me for a moment, I will become undone. This sort of like poverty of spirit is actually richness to God. So God is working to make you like pure gold, to have that pure gold. I mean, I'm hoping that most of us here, we have our ups and downs. I understand that. And I also understand that sometimes the Christian life can feel like two steps forward, one step back, two steps, one, but you're still going forward. But I understand there's sort of like, it's not just up all the time. I understand that often the Christian life is a little bit like the tide coming in, it goes out again, it comes in again, it goes out a bit, but all the while there's progress. So I'm not asking that we become super Christians overnight, but I'm assuming that most of us here, as we've grown grown as Christians through time, that we can say that actually our gold is purer than it was at the beginning. Sometimes you don't know that your gold or your faith is impure until it's tested. Sometimes when everything is going so wonderfully and amazingly, you feel you're flying with God. You feel like you're ready to, you know, conquer the world for Jesus. And then something happens and you realize that actually you weren't quite as strong as you were. And this is testing and trying and purifying your faith so that you can become stronger and stronger. Believing God's promises make you strong. Look at Abraham. He didn't have any of the Ten Commandments. He had no laws except what was evident about God. He didn't have the Mosaic law. So how did his faith grow? Because Abraham was extremely immature when he first came to God. He knew nothing about God until God revealed himself to him. He was a pagan. His father had idols. But he was given one promise that he would have a son called Isaac, and that through Isaac and his seed, all the world would be blessed. Well, that was hard for him to believe because it didn't happen straight away. And he made mistakes because his faith was impure. His trust was impure. He wasn't sure whether God was able to do what he said he'd do, or whether God was willing. Maybe God would change his mind. And so, you know, twice he gave up his wife, Sarah, who was to bring forth Isaac. Twice he said it was his sister and gave her up to be married to someone else. That's impure faith. Ishmael was impure faith. But by the time he was ready to sacrifice Isaac, believing that if he did have to sacrifice Isaac, God would have to raise him from the dead, his faith was pure. His trust was pure. Abraham was pure gold, not to begin with, but at the end, he was pure gold. And that's why Romans chapter 4 says that we who believe walk in the footsteps of the father of faith, Abraham. And so this is important for us to understand that this is what God sees as precious in our lives. Our trust and our faith in him is precious. And don't worry if at some times your faith seems weak. All that's happening, if you can understand what I'm saying tonight, if you feel your faith is weak, don't be too depressed, because what's happening? The Holy Spirit is purifying your faith. It feels weak because the purities are coming up, but very soon you'll come into a new level of purity. Your faith as gold is what is precious to God. Look at this. You can lay up treasures in heaven. You can put deposits in your heavenly account. God says, buy from me gold refined in the fire. So you can purchase for him. You can also deposit in a heavenly account, heavenly treasure. Matthew 6, verse 19 to 21. Don't lay up for yourselves treasures on earth. This is exactly what the Laodiceans were focused on. Treasures on earth, self-sufficiency on earth. I don't need anything. I've got everything I need on earth. Don't lay up for yourselves treasures on earth, where moth and rust destroy, and where thieves break in and steal. In other words, this stuff you can't take with you. And in the end, either if it's rust, moth, thieves, or you die, you can't take it with you. God does not value these things. He understands that they're necessary, and God is a good God, and God will at many times prosper his people materially, because that's his nature. But he puts no honor on these things. God is not impressed by the rich or by rich Christians, on the contrary. And here it says, lay up for yourselves treasures in heaven. Now, I think that when we are understanding that our faith is more precious than gold, that as we grow and become more pure, and our faith becomes even more pure and more precious in its purity, in its gold, that we are at the same time laying up treasures in heaven. How do you lay up treasures in heaven? How do you deposit in your heavenly account? If it's not by faith, if it's not faith, believing God, trusting God, dealing with circumstances and people by trusting and believing God, having faith for God to come through, having faith for the promises to come to pass. What is that but not laying up treasure in heaven? So once again, we can see that in a simplistic way, that faith is currency. Faith is currency. Faith gets from God, to put it maybe over bluntly. Faith gets from God. Faith gets God's attention. Faith is valuable to God. God values our faith. Without faith, it's impossible to please God. And faith and faithfulness, which is the same word, faith and faithfulness is the same. And faith and faithfulness deposits treasure in heaven that one day we will be able to inspect and we will be able to display to his glory. Another scripture here, a well-known scripture, in 1 Corinthians 3, not 2, 1 Corinthians 3, 9 to 15, not 2, 1 Corinthians 3. We're God's fellow workers, Paul says. You're God's field, you're God's building, according to the grace of God, which is given to me. As a wise master builder, I've laid the foundation, and another builds on it. Let each one take care how he builds on it, for no foundation can anyone lay which is Jesus Christ. Now, if anyone builds on this foundation with gold, there it is, gold, silver, precious stones, or wood, hay and straw, each one's work will become clear, for the day will declare it, because it'll be revealed by fire. And the fire will test each work of what sort it is. If anyone's work which he has built on it endures, he'll receive a reward. If anyone's work is burnt, he will suffer loss, but he himself will be saved, yet so as through fire. So Christians are going to get saved by grace through faith in the blood of Jesus, but we can build on this foundation of salvation by grace alone. We're all going to get to heaven, but some of us are building with gold, silver and precious stones, it's the same things. Things, these are pictures of valuable things, precious things. You know, gold, you can build with gold and silver your life. You can live by, your life can be gold to God, silver to God, precious to God. And this just takes on what I've been saying. Your faith is gold. Your trust is gold. Your belief is gold. That's what God esteems. That's what God honors. That's what God thinks is valuable. Wood, hay, straw. Well, you can imagine what that is. What is that? It's unbelief. It's Laodicean self-sufficiency. It's not mixing the gospel with faith. It's the children of Israel grumbling in the wilderness. It's the Moses generation, not the Joshua generation. And that's wood, hay, straw. Why? Because God does not esteem, value, or honor that kind of life. And then we get this picture on the day of believers' judgment, not judgment of whether you go to heaven or hell. If you're a believer, you've already been through that judgment and pronounced not guilty in Christ. All right. But this is a different judgment. This is a judgment to see how much of gold is in you. How much of gold is in you? How precious has your life been to the Lord in the way it's lived? And fire's going to test. Fire's going to test. Fire is going to show your life is going to be brought under the microscope. Your life is going to be looked at, and the way you've lived, the way you've believed, the way you've trusted, the way you've kept with God through good times and bad, that is going to exhibit itself, and you will shine like gold and receive a reward, or it'd be pronounced worthless. And the only thing that will get through the fire of testing is you yourself. You'll still be saved because Jesus did the work for that. And then finally, a few other scriptures. Here's a picture of how in James chapter 2, often we esteem wealth, riches and sufficiency over poverty or poor people. We want the people of influence, the people of money. That's who we are naturally drawn to, because they have the resources to do whatever we want them to do. My brethren, do not hold the faith of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Lord of glory, with partiality. For if there should come into your assembly a man with gold rings and in shining clothes, that's the Greek, gold, in fact, the Greek reads like this. For if there should come into your assembly a man with gold fingers and shining clothes. Remember, gold fingers and shining clothes. That's the literal Greek. And there should also come in a poor man in filthy clothes. And you pay attention to the one wearing the fine clothes and say to him, you sit here in a good place. And say to the poor man, you stand there or sit at my footstool. Have you not shown partiality among yourselves and become judges with evil thoughts? So there again is the idea of us esteeming the wealth of this world as being something to be prized. But God is the reverse. Look, verse 5. Listen, my beloved brethren, has not God chosen the poor of this world to be rich? To be rich. So God has blessed the poor. Not that poverty is a blessing, it's not a blessing. But God has blessed the poor in order to be rich. In what way? Because the poor person has no option but to believe God. No option but to trust God, perhaps for his meal or his clothes. He has no option. He is totally reliant on God for his provision, his future. He has no choice in it. And in that way, he's blessed. How hard is it for a rich man to enter the kingdom of heaven? It's not impossible, but it's hard. Why? Because of self-sufficiency. And that's why the poor flocked to Jesus, because they had nothing and in him they saw everything. Has not God chosen the poor of this world to be rich in faith? Rich in faith, So richness to God is the richness of your faith. How rich are you today? How rich are you today? Well, you might, well, not now because I've spoken about it, but initially you might want to look at your bank account or your salary or your pension scheme or whatever it might be. But God is saying, when God says, how rich are you? He's talking about your faith. Are you rich in faith, heirs of the kingdom, which are promises? Isn't that wonderful? And then right there in James 5, verse 1, come now, you rich, weep and howl for your miseries that are coming upon you. Your riches are corrupted and your garments are moth-eaten. Your gold and silver are corroded and their corrosion will be a witness against you. Now, you know, the rich in James's time were not acting very well. You can have very godly rich people, although it's harder to be a godly rich man than it is to be a godly person with meager result, with meager provisions, for the very reason that I've said. So as I conclude today, when I saw that verse in Revelation chapter 3, I counsel you to buy from me gold refined in fire that you may be rich. We are purchasing that gold, if you like, by our faith, by our trust. We're depositing in our heavenly bank account. We are purchasing gold. And that purchasing, how does that manifest? Our faith gets purer, stronger, our love gets deeper, our trust in God gets more powerful, the things of the world have less hold on us because our faith is like pure gold. And in the end, it's that purity of gold that God will value in our lives. It's more precious than gold, and it's to his glory. Be encouraged. God is purifying you to his glory. Amen. Thank you, Pastor Dorian.